I'm delighted that we are welcoming this remarkable songwriter and naming him the second fellow in the Center for Popular Music. The first, of course, was Barry Gibb. I hope a good number of you got to see him when he joined us here. Barry Gibb, the Bee Gees, was the very first fellow of our center, and it was an honor to have him and to continue at that remarkably high level of craftsmanship, artistry, and passion tonight.
The Fellows Program, as Dean Paulson mentioned, was created in 2013 with the intent to honor individuals of the highest distinction in the popular music world, both artistically and commercially. This is an honor that's reserved for a rare few people whose legacy and influence is so vast, so deep as to be inestimable. Their career success has brought them to iconic status in our culture. These are people without whom our music and our lives would be different. With that in mind, I can think of no more deserving person to honor as the next fellow of the Center for Popular Music than Lamont Dozier.
Thank you so much. This is so, so wonderful. This is really nice. I think about some of the many years that were put in working for a lot of songwriters. It's still happening, and I'm still giving my expertise in the art of songwriting, and as well as being able to encourage people to not give up, and if it's their true love and destiny, they can make it. Poor guy from Detroit, Michigan, if he can do it, anybody can do it. So. Thank you for this. This is so wonderful and so much appreciated. Thank you.
See, the thing was, if you recorded a song, I took it upon myself to cut the track. And if you don't get somebody to sing or dub in that track or do that song, you're going to be charged for that song. So it's coming out of your pocket, your own pocket at the end of the day. So I said, oh, I got to find somebody to sing this song. So I said, oh, man, because I can't be charged. I'm hardly making anything now, you know. So, oh, man. So I looked at the bottom of the list, and at the bottom of the list, we had a thing called, what is it? The No-Hit Supremes was at the bottom of the list.
No-Hit Supremes.
The No-Hit Supremes. And that's what everybody, all the rest of the artists used to tease them. And I said, Mary, oh, baby, I'm so glad to see you. You know, I got this song, I've been looking for you, this song I just finished writing, and it's for you. I'm telling you, it's gonna knock you, make you all big stars, I'm telling you. She said, what you talking about? Lamont, you talking about that song that you sent? I said, what's the matter? She said, that song, Gladys already told us about that song that you had, that you writing and trying to get somebody to do. I said, I know, what you talking about? I said, this song I wrote for y'all. I mean, you and the girls. She said, no, that song you wrote it for Gladys and them, and they turned it down. Now you're trying to give it to us. Always giving us the leftovers that nobody else wants. I said, oh, God. Barry heard the song. He said, wait a minute, I think y'all rethinking this. I mean, you're putting too much into this, Diane. I said, that's a hit, but Barry had great ears. Yeah. He said, this is a hit song. He said, I'm sorry to tell you, this is a hit song. At least the top 20. And I said, see that?
She looked at me. Hey, Barry said that.
Yeah, right. And she looked at me and told, huh. Yeah, okay. And so he said, get this ready, Brian, finish off. Y'all get in the money and get it, mix this thing. And get it out. We'll get it out next week. So they were glad they're going to get a release. You know what I mean? It's fine, you know.
No-Hit Supremes.
Yeah, No-Hits got a release coming out. So the thing, he released it in about 10 days, I guess it took. Record came out, man. And as everybody know that what happened to that record in the here, probably, it just took off and kept going. And didn't. It was number one for about like 5-6 weeks. And sold about 3.5 million copies.